JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for April the 15th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar traded mixed against the other G10 currencies on Tuesday during the Asian morning Wednesday. It gained against the Kiwi, the NOK, Aussie and the Canadian dollar in that order, while it underperformed versus JPY, CHF, GBP and the Euro in that order. The greenback was found virtually unchanged against the SEK. Now, the weakening of the risk-linked Aussie and Kiwi, as well as the slide in oil-related CAD and NOK, combined with the strengthening of the safe havens yen and franc, suggest that risk appetite eased at some point. Indeed, although most major EU and US indices closed in green territory, Asian bourses were mixed, with both Japan's Nikkei and China's Shanghai composite sliding 0.55 and 0.43% respectively. Now, EU and US markets may have remained supported due to prior signs that the coronavirus pandemic may be slowing down, which could result in the removal of some restrictive measures around the globe. Yesterday, White House advisor Larry Kudlow said that President Trump will proceed with a statement about reopening the US economy in the next couple of days, adding to hopes that this health crisis may be ebbing. That said, investors got a reality check during the Asian trading as the reported numbers of new infected cases and deaths worldwide revealed an acceleration again, with the number of deaths nearing its daily record. Again, I have the graph of the daily change in both cases and deaths, and you can see small acceleration in cases and the more notable one in deaths nearing its all-time daily peak. Now, remember yesterday we noted that just a day of new records may be enough to revive fears and trigger another round of risk aversion, and the overnight market reaction adds more credence to our view. We believe that it is too early for governments to reopen their economies, and if they do so, we believe that it must be a slow procedure in order to avoid a new flare-up. Having all that in mind, we stick to our guns that we would prefer not to trust a long-lasting recovery in the broader market sentiment. Even if equities rebound again, we prefer to take things day by day. Now, apart from headlines surrounding the coronavirus saga, today market participants may also pay attention to the Bank of Canada monetary policy decision. On March 27th, the bank decided to slash interest rates to 0.25% and to launch a quantitative easing program in order to safeguard its economy from the effects of the coronavirus spreading. The Governing Council highlighted its readiness to take further action to support the economy and the financial system, but noted that the policy rate is now to its effective lower bound. Last Thursday, the employment report for March disappointed largely, with the unemployment rate surging to 7.8% from 5.6%, and the net change in employment revealing that more than 1 million jobs have been lost, which is the worst print in Canada's history, at least since we can find the data from. This may have increased the chances for more stimulus by the Bank of Canada, but bearing in mind that officials clearly noted that the policy rate has reached its effective lower bound, we don't expect a rate cut at this gathering. Maybe officials will decide to expand their QE program, which could prove slightly negative for the Canadian dollar. Now, on the other hand, if they decide to hold off from acting due to the latest slowdown in the pandemic, the loonie may strengthen. Such a scenario is not off the books, as officials may prefer to wait and see whether the virus spreading will slow more and whether the already adopted measures have been having the desired effect on the Canadian economy. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the European morning, we get Sweden's CPIs for March. Both the CPI and CPIF rates are forecast to have declined to 0.7% year over year from 1%. But as we have noted several times in the past, we prefer to pay more attention to the core CPIF rate, which excludes the volatile items of energy. In February, that rate held steady at 1.6% year over year. Now, if the core CPIF rate stays close to its current levels, that would mean that the slide in the headline prints may be mostly due to the tumble in oil prices and may encourage Riksbank officials to wait for a while more before deciding whether to add additional easing measures. On the other hand, a notable slowdown in core inflation may prompt them to act again and expand further their QE purchases. From the US, we get retail sales, industrial production, both for March, and the New York Empire State Manufacturing Index for April. Both the headline and core retail sales are expected to have tumbled 7% month over month and 4% month over month after sliding 0.5% and 0.4% respectively. Those will be the biggest declines since we can find data from, but bearing in mind that investors already know that the US economy was hit hard due to the virus in March, big slides are unlikely to disappoint. The same applies to the industrial production, which is also expected to have slid notably. Market participants may pay some extra attention to the New York Empire State Index this time around. Although there are signs that the pandemic may be leveling off, this manufacturing index is expected to have fallen further into the negative territory to minus 35 from minus 21.5, which may be an early omen that the sector's wounds may drag for more than previously anticipated. A larger than expected tumble could raise questions as to whether the market and the ISM manufacturing prints for the US as a whole will disappoint as well. Now, with regards to the energy market, we get the Energy Information Administration report on crude oil inventories for last week. Expectations are for a 1.437 million inventory build, following a 0.476 million the week before. That said, bearing in mind that yesterday the American Petroleum Institute revealed a 13.143 million build, we see the risks surrounding the Energy Information Administration forecast as tilted to the upside. Oil prices slid yesterday, with WTI hitting once again the psychological zone of 20, and so a surge in the Energy Information Administration report could result in a break lower. Now, as for tonight, during the Asian morning Thursday, we get Australia's employment report for March. The unemployment rate is forecast to have risen to 5.5% from 5.1%, while the net change in employment is expected to show a 40,000 slide in jobs after the economy added 26,700 in February. At their most recent gathering last week, RBA policymakers left monetary policy unchanged and offered some details with regards to their QE program. They noted that they will do what is necessary to achieve a three-year yield target of 0.25%, with the target expected to remain in place until progress is being made towards the goals of full employment and inflation. However, they added that if conditions continue to improve, it is likely that smaller and less frequent purchases of government bonds will be required. Now, after saying that interest rates have reached their effective lower bound at their prior meeting, the aforementioned points suggest that there is very little chance of expanding their QE program. On the contrary, they could soon scale it back if the spreading of the coronavirus continues to level off. It would be interesting, though, to see whether a disappointing jobs report, with the unemployment rate rising further above the 4.5% threshold which the RBA expects to start generating inflationary pressures, will force them to change their minds and start considering a QE expansion. So, that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm hosting every Monday at 7 o'clock a.m. GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.